You're Near the Wild with Matt Becker and John Norris, recorded in Anchorage, Alaska.
All right, everybody, welcome to Near the Wild. I'm John Norris.
I'm Matt Becker in Anchorage, Alaska.
And I'm Ggreg Chaille in Sammamish, Washington.
I'm also in Anchorage, Alaska, I should have added.
We could fix that.
I think we need to just keep going. I don't know if it's going to get better than that.
No, that's it.
I think we hit the money on that one.
Oh, perfect. Ggreg, we haven't had you, your voice on the show in a couple episodes.
Well, you guys had the Australian band Longreef. They were visiting. They did like a month or two over at Coots?
I think two months. It seemed like they were around for a while, yeah, at least since Thanksgiving.
6 or 8 weeks, I think, is what the thing is. You know, interesting about that band is I remember, I think it was 4 years ago, we were trying to book them. And I remember in the podcast when I was editing it, they were talking about how it's so difficult to get into the United States to play, just to fucking play music. It's, I mean, forget about like displacing IT workers or, you know, with some of these other jobs where people think they're getting taken away. This is a musician. It took years. Part of it's probably their scheduling and stuff, but there's a lot of paperwork.
Well, according, after talking to them in depth about it, I think what you should do is start playing guitar and apply to come over. And by the time you're actually allowed to come over, you're probably going to be really good at guitar.
In elementary school.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm sure there is some American band that, you know, maybe they're not very good. Maybe they just do Creed covers. But they're probably pissed that these Australian bands are coming over and taking their jobs.
Oh, there's no shortage of bands who believe they should be on that stage. Quite often on the Sunday nights at Coots when we would have the local music night. And the band would approach me about how come they can't play a weekend gig. And I just saw your set. Are you're fucking joking, right? I mean, the weekend gig is a fucking job, man. It's five sets of music, and constantly having to update and I, you know, treating it like a real job, not something where you go up and, you know, stick a fucking microphone in your face and caterwaul until your set's over.
And did they not impress you with their open mic?
Not only did they not impress me, but I like local music. I just don't like when someone comes in and like slags off another band thinking that cover music is easy to do. That's me coming from a background of playing cover music in a band with a modicum of success on a level that I felt we did everything we wanted to do. And for 9 years, you know, made a good living. But when they come in and they think it's, you know, they're all hot shit because they can play, you know, a 1-4-5 blues riff and and somehow think that they're going to pull off some of these intricate numbers that, you know, Ettinger, a huge band that's been at Coots for, you know, 15 some years. And they look at that and go, what the fuck? You know, and those guys, Longreef, they've got a huge career just in originals.
Yeah.
Right. I know.
They gave us their album and I have been listening to it.
Yeah. I mean, but
it's real music.
It's real music. Exactly. And they've got real money behind them and their management company wasn't like, cover music. What are you doing? No, you need to focus on this. Like, the best way to get good at music is to play fucking music every night. That's it. There's a real simple solution to get good at your craft. And that's practice your craft as much as you can. And if you can get paid for that, fucking win-win. And a cover band is a great way to do that. Anyway, that's...
Yeah, and what they had said, though, after they were done, and, you know, that final night, they were hanging out with me in the birdhouse, and they said, this is the most work we've ever done. It was hands down the most work ever playing Coots.
Yeah, I mean...
In music?
You've constantly got to be, you know, attentive to the crowd, because if the crowds these days, I mean, we've talked about it on the show before, they're fickle, man. They don't give a shit. They would rather just have someone put their hands over a simulated turntable and, you know, play beats and do little things like that. And, you know, I'm not taking anything away from the guys who do a really good job at it. There's very few of them. But those guys, they know how to control a room, too. It's the same thing with a lead singer. It's just a little bit more difficult.
But they're playing. The band goes up there. They play for, like, what, 2 hours, 3 hours a night?
It's like 40-50 minute sets, and there's like four or five sets.
That's a long stretch of time they're playing, and that's for the entire week. That's work.
Yeah, that's a.
I did a gig in Guam, and we played six nights a week, and we were open till 4 a.m. every night. So it gets to be a grind, and
wow,
you got to. I mean, that's when you learn how to drink.
Is there a point where you're just like, it's late enough, we can start the set over?
Well, there are those nights where there's really, it's slow, you know. I've played gigs out in at the old Larry's Club out in Soldotna, or was that?
Sure.
I think that was Kenai, yeah. And we would play our first two sets on like a Wednesday night in the middle of winter with the bartender, his back to us as he's playing solitaire. This is before you had the app on your phone. He was just flipping cards over. And if anyone came in, they wanted to use the restroom or something. They certainly had nothing to do with our shenanigans. So we would play an entire set, and then we'd get to a new song. We'd go, hey, do you mind if we play that again? And, we'd have to remind the bartender that we were talking to him. I don't know why. He's the only one in the room besides us. But, we would just – he'd get away with it, right? It's like doing your open mic, you know. Not every night is a packed house in front of the Marijuana Logs crowd. So
true. Some nights you just, you talk about your dick to an empty room. Yep. That's when you know you're in it for the love.
Yeah. So how did the Marijuana Logs turn out?
It was good. I saw it a couple nights, and it was. I think the crowds really liked it. Tony Kameen was awesome. Nathan Hall and Cass both did awesome jobs.
So what he does is Tony takes a gig, and then he does a little advance work, finds two locals so that they will take over the other parts of the Marijuana Logs, since those guys don't all travel together.
Yeah.
Good.
I think it was fun. I think it was different, and people liked it. Seemed to, anyways.
Yeah. I got them all coming after show, and the bird, and they were all, they liked it. It was good, but it was a topic they liked, so.
Yeah. Becker, you said you went to the open mic last night?
It was fun. Everybody did good. There were a couple people from out of town that were back. Ari, what's his name?
Ari.
Ari something. He was Jewish.
Ari Shafir?
No, I know. That's what I was laughing about. No, but he just got back. He came up from L.A. or whatever. I don't know. Whatever.
I know Rudy Ascot is back.
Maybe. Is he Jewish?
I don't think so.
No, Rudy's the big guy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, he went up too. Yeah, he was good.
We should have Rudy on the show to talk about what it's like running out of money in Hollywood.
I think we all know what that's like. Didn't you see Pretty Woman?
So these are all local comics, Anchorage comics that have gone away and come back? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like some, a lot of people come back just for the holidays, but I know Rudy and I think Burgoon and Kyle Farrell have all left for greener pastures and found that open mics are hard everywhere you go.
Grass grows everywhere.
True.
Well, Burgoon's in Minnesota, right?
Yes. Bemidji, is that how you say it?
I think it is Bemidji. The Blue Ox.
Because it is the holiday season. We should talk about the holiday season.
Exactly.
But there's tons of this is a good time of year because lots of comedians just come back to visit their families and stuff.
Well, did you see the largest mall in America? They're having protests in it.
And is it still the Mall of America?
It's
Minnesota?
The Mall of America. Yeah, it represents America.
Sure.
So why are they having protests?
Well, they're protesting the whole Black Lives Matter. Unfortunately, they have signs up now that say you're not allowed to protest. This is a business, and you can't really block all this because the stores get panicky and they close their gates. So it makes shopping very hard this time of year, which is really supposed to be shopping.
Yeah.
And so the story leads with the fact they told them you got to go. You can't keep blocking the mall during Christmas week. And they go, but Black Lives Matter. And they go, okay, well, they can, but they're going to do it from jail then.
Turns out hundreds and hundreds of people with a socially conscious message and picketing signs and locking elbows can kind of put a damper on your business. Is that what you're trying to?
Yeah,
you're trying to tell me that.
I'm just trying to go to KB Toys. I don't know why you guys are all standing here.
And what's funny is, yeah, you get a lot of the pasty white Norwegians that are going, I just want you to know, your Black Lives Matter as much as mine do. And I go, well, that's fine, but I'm trying to go to the store. So either way, get out of the way. You know, I mean, that's it. I just don't understand what the protest is. I don't know if they know how that Bloomington, Minnesota works, but that mall pays a lot of taxes.
Yeah.
And that pays for the cops.
Well, we just went through the biggest shopping weekend of the year. This last weekend.
Was that this? I didn't even buy a thing. I spent no money.
Well, it was Saturday. That was the, I mean, they tagged these little names on it. It's almost like you start to ignore them, like the different colored ribbons. You don't even know what they fucking mean anymore. But they attached a name to Saturday. I already forgot what it was. But you know, they have Black Friday and all that. For,
sure.
For these days that are going to be hallmarks in retail. And they were expecting $10 billion to be spent on Saturday.
What was Saturday called?
I don't know. I so it's my point is like
Christmas hump day?
Yeah.
I mean, I never heard anything.
Oh, shit, it's Christmas? Last fucking minute buying?
I always hated it when they did the small business one. They did that like on the Tuesday after Black Friday. After I go, by the time people are broke, go to small businesses.
Yeah.
Well, this year they talked about how like Black Friday was really disappointing and it didn't make as much money as they thought it would. But that the whole like week, because now it's like it's the whole week of Black Fridays, basically.
Yeah.
It made more money just over like a 7-day period of time instead of in one day.
Well, you know what they're doing now is stores are open for the next like 72 hours straight. No closing.
Yeah. And they all like and they all do price matching. So it doesn't matter where you go anymore.
Well, no, I go to my computer. That's where I
yeah,
go.
Yeah, just buy stuff online.
Yeah.
That's how we – why are people even in the mall? They should be buying stuff online. Once the protesters start sitting in on Amazon.com, I'll start to worry.
Yeah, or blocking UPS trucks.
Sure.
You can disrupt Christmas.
No, that's how they should – that's a good idea, Becker. You should be an organizer.
Uh-huh.
They're doing nothing and sitting in the mall.
Amazon Prime matters.
They should be sitting. They should be blocking the gates of the UPS lot.
Yeah, I. You know what's weird is I believe now because you know the post office this year to keep up with all the private deliveries.
Mm-hmm.
They started
putting two people in the post office instead of one like every other fucking day.
They literally still have one person in there.
Oh my god,
unbelievable! But no, what they did is they started. Deliver on Sundays now, and they're going, hey, we deliver on Sundays now. We're gonna deliver your package on Sunday, and I have yet to get a package from them that came on a Sunday, but I have noticed I have not been getting mail on Saturday.
I thought that was the thing, how they were gonna save money. They were gonna stop doing Saturday delivery, and then they never said they did it now.
What they're doing is they're just not deliver, and on Monday I get a big pile of stuff now. But I've yet to get the Sunday special, but I'm not getting mail now on Saturday, which I said, you never said you quit doing it.
Maybe
but I think they quit doing it.
I mean, let's face it. They're making up their own rules over there. But maybe what they're doing is they're doing package delivery on Sunday. Could that be it?
Yeah, no, I'm saying they're doing package delivery. I'm saying I'm not getting my regular mail on Saturday.
We don't need regular mail on a Saturday. We don't need regular mail on a Sunday. Who the fuck cares?
Yeah, we just need regular mail on those other days, and sometimes that doesn't happen.
Yeah,
I think we got 3 days a week if it got to the right box. I have my father-in-law's Sports Illustrated, which he loves college basketball.
Uh-huh.
And this is the insider to college basketball season kicking off and all the trades and everything he'd like to know. And I have this now been a week. I forgot to bring it down to him.
Oh, wow.
He's losing his goddamn mind.
Well, no, he doesn't know. He doesn't know.
You're missing it. Here's what you do. Now you go make yourself a homemade little card, and you put it in there, and you go, your subscription starts now. Merry Christmas.
I should cut it up.
Yeah, yeah.
I should cut it up and make a collage. This is yours. Oh, yeah. No, but that's the thing is the missing of the mail is one thing. But, yeah, it's just I don't get it. I don't know how the post office is going to continue at the rate they're going.
Well, I hope they do because I've just started taking over the merch for Doug Stanhope, and we're using a lot of USPS.
It's a great deal, though, isn't it?
Yeah.
Those priority boxes, it's like, what is it, $18? You can mail rocks. I can mail you rocks.
Yeah, the flat rate shipping thing is amazing.
But That's not what we're doing. I mean,
I want kettlebells.
I'll ship things USPS, but I give that as an USPS priority. I'll ship it that way, but that's an option. The cheapest way to ship something is still to go first class, and then you get the boxes, you get your own custom boxes that actually fit a CD or a DVD, and that's the cheapest way to send stuff. Still,
actually, you want to know the trick? The cheapest way to send something in post office?
FedEx or UPS?
No, post office.
Yeah,
United States Post Office. All you do is you get a box, fill it up, do everything you do normally, and then you put on the where you want it to go in the return address, and then you put your name in the delivery spot with your address. Then you drop it in the mailbox, and what they'll do is return it to the return address, saying there was no postage.
No postage.
Yeah.
Have you tried this?
Yeah, it works great. That's how we sent out our wedding invitations.
I don't understand how that isn't like the biggest scam. Like everyone does that. That seems like it would work.
Yeah. Yeah, it does actually.
I mean, I attended your wedding, so I know it worked once.
Uh huh. But yeah, it's just it's a loophole, I guess you'd call it. I'm sure it's a felony. Remember, anything to do with the post office is a felony. Like they're federal workers. You can't touch them. You can't thing. You can't talk to them.
That has to be the best way to end up in federal prison. Yeah. What did you do? I was just trying to save 35 cents. And now here I am.
Yeah.
I read about the scam, the big scam this holiday season, and I guess every holiday season, is like buying something like an Xbox or a TV or something and then returning the box with like a brick in it.
Or something that feels something. like what was taken out of it, like the goods that were in there.
I guess maybe if you have a broken TV, just buy a new one and return your broken one.
Or just take out the guts of the TV and put the shell of the, you know, not the TV, but like a VCR or something. You could put in something that would, you know, basically, it's got to get close so it doesn't feel like liquid in there. You know what I mean? You're doing it wrong if you return a VCR and it feels like sloshing.
Your VCR is leaking, sir.
It's seven pounds of cottage cheese. This is what I bought. I was confused too.
A live puppy.
Exactly. Why is that in there? You tell me.
Look at him. He's a little PlayStation, that thing.
So apparently, this is costing the Walmarts of the world like millions and millions of dollars.
I don't think I've ever returned a big item that had been open. Are they sealing it so it doesn't look open? Is that what they're claiming?
Yeah.
Okay, because like I say, I don't think I've ever returned something where they didn't go through and check to make sure even the free batteries were in there. So
I don't know. Maybe like
this might be a scam working off the fact their friends are bringing stuff back.
That could be it maybe. Too. Yeah.
I mean, there is a point when you pay people $9 an hour that they start screwing you.
Why?
I watch Hogan's Heroes. I know what happens when you're underpaid.
But in high school, we all worked at a surf shop, and my friends ended up perfecting this little method. They would take an order from people at school, and they'd say, like, yeah, I want to get a pair of neoprene booties, a cap. You know, whatever you wanted, wetsuit, a whole wetsuit. You know, it's like $200. He would go to work over the weekend at the surf shop, and then he would take out the trash, you know, every so often. And in the trash, he would put the things that people ordered. And then at the end of the shift, when they closed up at night, he would pretend to leave, but then he would just go back to the trash can, pull all the stuff out of the trash, and then take it to school on Monday, and then hand it out and collect cash. There's a million scams.
Huh.
Yeah.
The inside job is the best.
Oh, that's a good one. I used to do that with gum. I used to take the gum out and just fold the paper back up and sell kids empty things of gum.
You didn't put anything in there, like leaves or anything? So they just...
No, nothing. Just, yeah.
I had the friend who worked at the pizza place, and so we would call and order like four pizzas for delivery, and then after like between 20 and 30 minutes, you call and cancel your order. And so they've already made all the pizzas, and then you do this like at the end of your friend's shift, and he just takes all the pizzas and brings them over.
Yeah, good timing on that will dictate how many pizzas you get.
Yeah.
When I was in school in Indiana and living, vicariously through the college life, I used to do the thing where they dented cans, they put them on sale. So you go and find what you want, you just bang them on the counter, And then you'd come back about 3-4 days later, and they're like 10 cents a can because they're dented, and that can cause botulism and things. So they have a limited time to.
Does it cause botulism?
Yeah, if it hasn't. If you dented the can where it got air in and stuff, you could kill you. That's why they always discounted it. They stopped doing that, I think.
It seems like you should either sell it at full price, or if it's dangerous or potentially dangerous, you shouldn't be selling it.
Well, because remember, like, the trucks would somehow sometimes crush the cans on a, you know, when they have them on the yeah. pallet thing, they would crush, like, a corner of the beans were crushed. Well, they said if they were open, they need to be used immediately. So that was the idea behind discounting it, to get them used.
So there's a real art to denting the can so that you don't give yourself botulism.
Oh, yeah. I used to dent jeans, too.
Clearly, that's a dent.
Yeah.
I'm not paying full price for these 501s.
I am not a rube, sir. The circus is uptown. I want a discount.
Maybe you'd pay for that, sir, but not me.
I think I need to do that. I think I need to go back to the haggling wars. They don't do it much anymore. Remember, you'll see things online, you know, like ways to save money at the mall or whatever. And then do like, even like Target, you can talk to the manager, give you an extra 10% off. Well, yeah, but it's marked up 70%. You know that. Pair of headphones for $80.
Yeah, I think haggling is definitely a thing that doesn't happen very often anymore.
It's a lost art.
Once they got rid of the sticky tape that said what the price was, now you got no proof. You get to the girl at the cashier until she scans it. She can't work a deal.
Yeah.
You're like, I will give you $7. She goes, hang on, I have to scan it first. And you go, I will give you $8. I have to scan it first.
Well, I think back when humanity did all their shopping in like a big flea market type situation, like everybody was haggling for everything all the time. But now we're just out of practice. Nobody knows how to do it. Like I would be very self-conscious. I would probably end up paying more than the actual price and feel like I won.
I actually still do it. I still haggle.
Everywhere?
Farmers markets and stuff like that. Yeah, you get them to kick something else in, you know?
These cucumbers look like shit. I'm not paying that price.
See, he's bundling.
Yeah, bundling. I'm bundling. I'll take those shitty looking cucumbers that I'm not paying full price for. But I'll tell you what, I'll pay that full price if you throw in those two tamales.
And you pickle these cucumbers for me.
This is the time of year when you realize, okay, I'll give you some just simple shopping things that have made me wonderful and successful for all my years. Is okay, let's see what you do. You get like things like hats. Like you go to a novelty store, you get the hats.
Like a novelty store. What do you mean a novelty right. store?
Like a costume store. Like we'll say if there was a world where they had parties, like a party. And you go there. Now you got small items. So that's called bundling. What you do is you throw those in the top hat. Then right at the very end of your trip, when you get all these little items that are high dollar, I might add too, yeah. way more than it should be because tilty cards that make different shapes, rings, put poison rings with the diamond on it, but it opens up. And so it has a little container so you can put cocaine in it or something.
Or something.
Anyway. There was something. But anyway, so you got all that stuff. And then what you do is you decide at the last minute you want another top hat. So you get the other top hat. And then you squeeze the two top hats together. And then you have one top hat.
You now, stack you one get... inside the other, creating almost a false bottom.
Yes.
When you look into the top hat, you see nothing, right?
Like a magic trick. Hence why top hats are so successful. And but then you got to get through that what I like to call the 14-year-old seasonal hire. Who goes, I'm just gonna wear it out. So you put it on your head after they scan it, so they never actually come in contact with it.
Yeah.
And then you walk out with thing, and I mean, it's their fault for not ringing it up. Don't mind me, I'm not stealing from these stores, because that would be wrong. But if they fail to ring it up, that's, you should hire a better person,
maybe someone more thorough.
Mm-hmm. That I guess that is a tip I could try to use everywhere, maybe.
Yeah, it works. It works. I don't know if you've ever bought rubber boots at the store, but you can fill those things full like pinatas, man.
Sure.
Those things. And they don't look. They're just like that. Have you noticed the lethargic now in the cashiers with the fact that it just is all scanned and stuff? They just have dead in their eyes and they're like, nah, 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 nah. Yeah. And when stuff doesn't scan up, they freak out. They're like, oh my God.
Where's the manager?
I have to put numbers in.
They're just waiting for the days when like robots are going to come in and just murder them and take over their register.
We've already taken it over. I'm getting pretty good at scanning.
I'm still terrible at it.
Oh, you scan?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't want to use it for the longest time until I figured out that one part, you know, the part where if you accidentally got some steaks, some really expensive steaks And you're grabbing a newspaper, the local newspaper, because you want to stay informed, and you might wrap the stakes in them later. You stick the stakes inside the newspaper. It slid in there. I didn't know. But when you go across and ring up the paper, as long as you get the weight about right, that thing demagnetizes the stakes.
So you got to make sure you get the Sunday paper. You scuttle three
get
quarters.
Get rid of the ad. You don't need the ad.
Get rid of the
ad. You're shopping now. I don't need ads. You're going to be buying ads while I'm shopping.
I'm already in the store. Why are you even selling me the ads? All right. So then you take out the ad section, put in your hanger stake, and you got to approximate it, and then you slip it right back down into your bag.
Boom. $1.50 steaks. I'm telling you, I don't know how people are starving to death in this country.
Well, I mean, the real problem with the those like U-scan things, there's like six or more like stations where people scanning, and there's still one like store clerk employee like who's now in charge of all of those, and she's like losing her goddamn mind because there's like at least four people at all times who don't know what's happening.
No, that's every, exactly
like
it.
They're trying to like scan a kiwi and it's coming up as like a box of fish and they're this like everyone's upset. So I feel like they're just asking for one of their employees to lose their mind on some customers.
What I did blatantly this year was I brought, because pumpkins are a ripoff. I mean, they got you at Halloween. You want a pumpkin in July. They're not fast sellers. But they marked it up. It was like 23 cents for a minute. And then I went back to the store and they were $1.29 a pound. I go, are you kidding me? So anyway, I get a nice healthy pumpkin. But the beauty is if you got a small one, she might be watching closer. But because I got one, I actually needed two hands. I had to come up, set it next to U-scan, go get my cart, come back, did the U-scan. And then I pick up my pumpkin and put it in the cart and roll right past her. It was kind of amazing, really. Because the biggest thing in the whole room at that point was my pumpkin, and she almost wanted to help me put it in. I go, dang, no, I got this for the money I saved. And the irony is, and I will tell you this, if you're even going to buy a pumpkin, always carve it in the store, because you're paying by the pound, and all those seeds and stuff you're going to throw it at home,
that's true, take the guts out.
So get the guts out of there, clean it in the store. They got all the utensils over and hardware. You're good.
Yeah, kitchen gadgets. It's all there.
So once you got that pinata of a pumpkin, fill it up with stuff. Put some candy in there. Get it in. Get your money's worth.
Some steaks.
Yeah.
I kind of get the feeling that like people know what you're doing in the store, but everybody that works there is like, I'm not going to say anything. He looks like the kind of guy who would make a big scene.
The wintertime, when you go into a store without gloves and you come out with gloves, it looks normal. It's winter. Of course I had gloves and a new hat or a hat.
That's the trading up shopping.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, the line of the customer service is too long. I'll just trade out right here, guys. I got it. I'll even restock for you.
It's the old flea market trick. Come in with mittens, leave with kittens.
You know, it's a wonder that businesses stay in business. I mean, there's a million scams. I mean, these are funny little anecdotes, but there are a million scams out there that are just, you know, stuff's flying off the shelves. There's rings in New York City. I've seen the news articles on rings of people organized individuals who are actually shopping as shoplifters, shopping off of a list that they take back, and then it's resold on the black market in New York.
Yeah.
Yeah. I love those. I love all those like videos you'll see of like security footage from like JCPenney or Sears or like another store where it's just like two people like walk in and then a couple minutes later they like walk out of the big screen TV and like nobody says anything to them.
No, I did that when I was younger. I mean, before it was illegal. It wasn't a big screen.
Wait, before stealing was illegal?
Well,
I think that was one of those things that was carved on the stones.
Yeah, Hammurabi's law.
when I wasn't 21 or 18 yet, remember it was like call your parents if you got caught, but I never got caught. My mom, I recently talked to my mom and she said, "You were bad kids." I go, "We never got caught once, Mom."
Yeah.
She goes, "I got called by a store detective once." I go, "About another kid who got caught, not yeah. about me." He didn't follow the rules. I used to take a big gulp in the store, right? And I made a false top so it had ice on top. And then you would just lift the canopy up and then you'd fill it up with stuff and walk out. And one time this got stopped and I set the big gulp up there full of stuff and he searches me. which is probably illegal now. I could have sued him.
Yeah.
But he searched me and he goes, okay, you can go. But I know you're up to something. And I pick up the big gulp and go, I know. Slurp, slurp.
Have a good day.
Have a nice day. It was sitting right in front of you, you idiot. But no, that's how I started doing magic with shoplifting. Stuff would disappear and it would reappear outside.
Shoplifting is a gateway to magic? Is that what you're trying to tell me?
I think, yeah, it's a pretty hardcore, yeah. Because eventually everybody goes, I wonder if I can make an elephant disappear. I mean, I'm sorry, but if you can make an elephant disappear, you're a good shoplifter. Or a horrible pet store.
What was your inspiration to make that 747 disappear? Well, when I was young, I really liked Zagnut bars, and I had no money.
The worst story ever, though, is on Mother's Day one time, we go to this little store, and I think it was sixth grade. I went in with a book because I figured this out. You could take a book and you take greeting cards. You could throw them in the spine of the book, and then you could shake the book. The greeting cards wouldn't fall out.
Yeah.
So I went in and got a thing, gave it to my mom. My mom goes, oh, you got me a Mother's Day card. That's nice. How much do you pay for it? I'm like, $6. Or whatever, $2. And she goes, oh, no, it says actually it's $4.99 on the back because it was the code thing in the back. I didn't even realize that.
Discount.
And she goes, you didn't steal a Mother's Day card for me, did you? And I go, I wouldn't do that. I'm your son. So, yeah, that was when things should have turned. That's usually the story when people stop doing that. Then I just started learning the codes.
Do you think it's gotten easier or harder to steal from stores now? Because now they have more security features, but they also have a lot more employees who probably give less fucks.
No, they do, yeah.
But the employees that they've increased are the eye in the sky. There's cameras everywhere. Even if there's not cameras everywhere, there's that smoky one-way mirror glass of a camera bubble up above you that's always looking down. You don't know if it's looking at you or not.
Yeah, and I have friends that work in that field, and they showed it. I mean, they can blow you up to the point where they can tell if you have a nose ring or not.
Yeah.
And what you don't realize is you may get away with it today, but they keep it on file, and they have face recognition programs. So as soon as you walk in any of the stores, they know who you are, they know you stole previously, and they will get you. You want to know the worst story you ever told me? This is the worst story. He stopped a big, huge, 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 huge fat guy. He went in the liquor store, and the guy had just in the liquor store had just restocked like Captain Morgan's, you know, the flask ones, the plastic flask.
Uh-huh.
Like the flat ones, like the hip flask in your pocket.
He had just restocked that aisle, and the guy went down it, and they knew he was up to something. He's, you know, he's fucking filthy pig guy with a fucking backpack. And he goes, I know he took something. So they went down the aisle. And he told him, I just restocked it. And he goes, there's Captain Morgan's bottle missing. And he goes, I know he took it because he was the only guy to walk in. They had him on camera, but they couldn't find it. And so he has him up in the thing. Well, here's the deal. If you stop someone and search him, you can actually get sued. You can only stop if you have an item you saw them take. And if you can't prove it, you're in a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
And he said, you can work there for 16 years. They'll let you go if you get a guy and he sues and you don't get it. So what happens is he can't find it and he's getting more worried and the guy's thing. And finally it dawns on me, he goes, Jesus Christ, he's got his shirt off because he goes, I need to search you. And he's got him in the office, he searched him with another person there watching. And he finally goes, son of a bitch. He lifts up a roll of his fat and reaches up underneath. And he said it smelled just like an unkept belly button. And it was greasy and it felt like Vaseline. And he pulls it out of one of his rolls and it goes and there was the bottle and they charged him.
Ugh.
The perfect crime is that then they went ahead and sold that bottle to me next when I walked in. I said, good man, where is your spiced rum?
Your freshest bottle of spiced rum, please.
You don't even know how spicy that rum is, sir.
It's over by Pumpkins. Oh my God. But yeah, that was his worst story ever. And he goes, I almost quit the job after that.
I'll put a link in the show notes. There's a show I just found. It's a BBC show, and it's a bunch of small segments on loss prevention in the UK, and these guys that go around and shoplift, and just the capers that these guys. It's like you said, these guys are like they're trained they're training their cameras on someone and handing them off from camera to camera and following them around the store. And it's pretty awesome. And it's just, you know, two or three guys in a back room, and they're following them all the way through. And they right to when they see, like, okay, he picked up that perfume, and now where is it? You know, and they got, and yeah. And they also show you little tricks.
But the pros, yeah, the pros are amazing, because they'll like wrap stuff in tinfoil. They do, I mean, they do everything to beat the sensors.
The one I don't know if you know about this, Becker, and I know you don't know about this, John.
I don't.
Because you don't have a background in magic.
I'm honest. I'm an honest person.
The little sensors, those little tabs that they put in all the products, that when you go through security, that it'll beep at the door. Those sensors only trip it if you go between those two parallel bars, those two vertical parallel bars. That's that's the sensing area. If you hold the item above your head,
yeah,
you can walk right through there undetected.
That's why Nigerians always carry stuff on their heads. It is. That's a fact.
Well,
even outside,
whatever.
Everywhere.
Multiple times I've like, you know, you try to buy something and they scan it, and you pay for everything, but they don't demagnetize those.
Yeah.
Sensors, and you walk out and it beeps, and then like somebody's just like, I'll just go ahead. It goes off all the time.
What they're supposed to do, here's the deal, because he told me about this too, is they said in loss prevention, he goes, when the beeper goes off at the door, that's the cashier's fault, and they can actually get dinged for it if they have too many that come out of their line that ding it.
Yeah.
But their job is to go check to see what item wasn't rang. They don't, loss prevention does not come after you when that thing goes off. But you watch these people with two carts of stuff standing there going, what do we do now? And they come back and they have to go there. I go, just keep walking.
Yeah.
That's what he said. Just go. He goes, if they stop you, you've got a hell of a lawsuit.
Yeah.
Because it's their fault for not deactivating. But I've watched these people stop. The other thing, if you are stealing and you wait for somebody with two huge carts going and you just cut right between them.
Yeah, yeah.
And if it does go off, it's obviously the two carts of stuff, yeah, not yeah. the guy running with a baseball cap.
Diversion, yeah. Yeah, a guy quick walking to his car. With one big like Popeye arm that's stuffed full of meat.
always have the getaway car waiting for you.
Yeah.
You know, one of my greatest items I ever got too was a pair of Converse. I bought, you know, Chuck Taylor's, which used to be $20, are now $50 somehow. I don't understand, but I bought them and they were high tops and they had a security tag on them. Still, they didn't take the ones with the ink in them, so you can't break
the tough plastic that has a pin through like one of the eyelets or something.
Right. And so I had that on that and I thought, well, I will just run around with these. I mean, it was funny to me, but here was the deal. It would set the sensor off on the way in, but then it would, when I'd walk out, it was already registered as being in the store apparently or something. I don't know how it worked, but it wouldn't go off on the way out. So it would go off on the way in. So every time I'd walk in, if somebody's walking out, it would go off for them and they would act like, oh, what do I do? And I go, I knew it was my shoe. So that part was always funny. But when I was in Las Vegas, I got stopped repeatedly by people, you name it, streetwalkers, homeless guys, pit bosses at the casino. Hey, you've got a security tag on your shoe. I mean, they all were fascinated with the fact it was on there. And I laughed. I go, these aren't great basketball shoes, but they're great running shoes.
You never ran into a guy in all your travels like, you know, for $20, I'd get that off of there for you.
No, I mean, that was the thing. They go, if you go back, they'll take that off for you. And I go, I like it on there. It was funny.
It's like Becker's version of Minnie Pearl with the hat.
Yeah, it was. But it was just, yeah, it was perfect. So I think I'm going to get security tags for all my stuff.
Well, you know, it's yours.
You can probably just buy those on Amazon.
Yeah, you can buy the knockoffs that are, because they have decoy ones and real ones. So you never know which one you got.
You'd fill them up with ink on your own.
Mm-hmm.
Just buy a case of pens.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's our Christmas shopping stories of so if you're gonna go out shopping, you got last minute stuff to do it right at the last minute when they're overwhelmed.
Yeah, we hope we gave you some tips on saving some money.
And dress nice, because nobody in a suit steals.
Near the Wild holiday gift guide. what are you guys doing for Christmas? What are you doing for Christmas, Ggreg?
My Christmas is over, guys.
You're done?
I'm done.
I think I read the Bible. I don't think you're done.
No, I'm done. We do a Christmas during Thanksgiving with my mother, who comes up from Los Angeles, and that's why Tracy and I came up to Washington to stay at my brother's house. And we bang it all out right then, man. Gift giving, everything. Not having a tree. So we've dubbed it Thanksmas, and all this other nonsense, I'm just pissed because there's traffic, and I just stay out of the stores. So it works out pretty good for me. I'm done, guys. I'm already towards the new year.
So what do you do? You just chill out and watch Netflix?
Yeah, watch some football. Huh. Have a good time. Going to the stores. Make some food. My brother's got a really good kitchen here, so we do a lot of cooking. So we'll do that. We'll have some kind of a menu planned. I went to my storage unit and picked up a set of drums and a bass guitar and an amp. So we'll get drunk here and play some music and yeah.
That's great. You should do an album.
That's our Christmas.
Record an album.
Watching dogs, taking care of the chickens, making good food, drinking, and playing music right now.
Ggreg, if you want to be successful, you got to do what the other bands aren't willing to do. That's record an album on Christmas.
I'll see if maybe Tracy wants to put something down on wax for you guys.
Please.
I'm interested now. That's actually a great Christmas tradition. That's more fun than most things. I, of course, will be. We decided not to put up a tree this year.
Yeah.
We leave so soon after that it just added stress. And so we just didn't. But we have our Christmas lights up. So that's good without the tree, which is weird, but
it's just a skeleton.
Yeah, it's a coat rack with some lights hanging on it, but you know, it's there. And we don't do gifts. We that's why we've been married so long, is we agreed right off. We have too much stuff. Why, what are you going to get me? You can't get me anything. Don't buy me anything. And it works. It works pretty good, actually.
Nice. But, I have a tree, which is. I guess I'm the only one out of the three with a tree right now, and it's I like it. I like having the tree up. I feel very in the spirit this year. I think for the past, I can't remember the last Christmas where I felt really like the holiday spirit was alive in me, but I feel it this time.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm digging Christmas this year, and I dig, like, yesterday was the solstice. The days are getting longer and lighter, and haven't even felt like winter hardly.
I was at the at 3:33. I was in traffic waiting to turn on Lake Otis, and I watched the streetlights come on.
Yeah,
at 3:33 in the afternoon.
I was out shooting. A group hired me to shoot a little video for them, and then we're doing some interviews outside. I said, like, we have about 20 minutes of light. So
you picked the worst day for this.
But yeah, I feel I'm. You know, I'm done with my holiday shopping. I have a very limited amount of people that I actually buy gifts for. So I'm on the back end of it. I'm just hanging out now.
Yeah, it's a pretty easy slide to Christmas Day now for you.
Yeah, I'll just I'm gonna drink some. I don't know if I like eggnog, but I might give it a chance this year.
Well, I don't know if you guys have ever made eggnog, but I'm making actual. I'm gonna go out and actually create. Find a recipe and create our own concoction of eggnog.
Isn't it just like egg and milk and spices and rum?
Something like that. Sure. You can, there's whiskey or you can use rum. There's a non-cook method and there's a cook method. You're using egg yolks. So I am probably going to cook.
Wouldn't the eggs thicken if you cooked it?
They do thicken. You're not cooking it like scrambled eggs. You're cooking it at low heat. And you're going real slow, and then you're adding the milk to that so that they don't ever really
congeal
like cooking scrambled eggs. But I've never made it before, which is great because, it's, like, I just made my own hummus the other day. I love having this kitchen. It's a great kitchen to be in.
I just made hummus the other day as well, Ggreg. We need to start swapping recipes.
Well, I did an adobo chili hummus.
Oh, look at you.
That's pretty kick-ass.
What's the thing you add to hummus to make it taste right?
Tahini.
It's the, yeah, that's
tahini
it, yeah.
is like sesame butter. Think of like peanut butter. That's what tahini is. But it's basically tahini, chickpeas, garlic, and lemon juice, and a little bit of salt. That's it.
Yeah,
tahini is ungodly expensive up here.
Oh yeah,
but luckily, like one jar will last you like 4 years.
You can get it at Fred Meyer.
It's still like $10-$11 for a jar of tahini.
Oh wow, that's double what it is down here.
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, there's ways to get it cheaper, but yeah. But yeah. And I'm amazed with hummus because, yeah, that's the one that people will make their own, and it's good. But I still like the store brand better.
Yeah, it's tough when you've got something like that. The cost of a thing of hummus is less than half the cost of the smallest container of tahini.
Yeah.
But it is you can get different flavors.
We have we do the eggnog, the eggless eggnog, we call it. It's a rum. It's good. I've never got sick from rum.
Well, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do homemade eggnog. We're doing lamb, like a rack of lamb, but we're doing just the lollipops. So it's just like the ram. Yeah, we're doing that. And then the only other thing is mac and cheese. That's what Tracy wants for Christmas.
I dare you to give out your address right now. I dare you.
Just listen for the bass and the drum playing.
Yes. They're at it again with their crazy legs of lamb and hummus.
So, John.
Yeah.
What do you attribute your festive mood to?
You know, I don't really know. It just, for some reason, I'm listening to holiday music this year. I'm watching Christmas movies. It feels like a good winter to me so far. I think I like that winter started late. It gave me time to move on from the season of fall into winter, and now it feels good. It feels right.
But I think you nailed it right there. You're so used to it being bitterly cold and tons of snow on the ground that maybe just your body's telling you it's time to leave Alaska.
Yeah, I think I usually am I'm usually really sick of winter by this time.
Yeah, you've said that in the past, that by this time you're already thinking forward of being somewhere else. And then when you get somewhere else, you just want to be back to Alaska.
But right. Becky's parents had their 35th year open house, their Christmas open house, and and it snowed that the night before. It was perfect, so everything's all billowy white.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah. So that might be part of it, John, is that this has been a perfect year. Not a lot of winter, but then it snowed right at the right time. Now everything's all white and nice again.
Yeah.
People got Christmas lights everywhere this year.
It's been great. It's been a great great winter so far.
Well, all right.
The only thing, one more thing I wanted to say. The only thing I want for Christmas is more Twitter followers. So everybody find me at JNorris123 on Twitter.
All right. Maybe we can make that come true.
That'll be in the show notes. I did put that in the show notes about, what is it? Tim Madonna?
Timothy Madonna. He's loving us.
Yeah. He's contacted me a couple of times already about, his mention. So
I think he just fucking tweeted at me. Now is does he have a live feed onto this? What is going on?
I get he must somehow has a live feed of the podcast.
Does he have a job? Because I think he's sitting there monitoring. I think you have a stalker and just don't know it.
His job is number one Near the Wild fan. That's all the job he needs.
That's
all right.
At Timothy Madonna, guys, go find him.
And this is actually a weird year because we didn't put a tree up, which is weird because we have three chihuahuas, and that's usually their gift, is not have to go outside. So they're a little disappointed. The other thing is, I was just talking to somebody last night, and I said, besides myself, I think Ggreg Chaille is the only guy who can quote every line in It's a Wonderful Life.
I am not that good. I've been slacking off.
I don't Tony Kameen. I go, you want to try? I go, I'm telling you, pick a spot. Zuzu's pedals.
I'm better at Fast Times at Ridgemont High, but I have not sat down and watched that movie in its entirety in probably 2 years. So I think that's going to be one of my goals this season, is to watch it. Always reminds me of my dad. So that's why I like watching it. Yeah.
All right. It's official. It's been another episode of Near the Wild. I'm Matt Becker in Anchorage, Alaska.
I'm John Norris, also in Anchorage, Alaska.
And I'm Ggreg Chaille in wonderful Sammamish, Washington.
Happy holidays.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
You've been listening to the Near the Wild podcast with Matt Becker and John Norris, recorded in Anchorage, Alaska on Matt Becker's backyard bus. Engineered by me, Ggreg Chaille.
2 inches of snow. That's a bragging point now.